Well, I'd like to thank you guys for coming out. I'm sure we're going to have a very attentive audience for this panel. My name is Grant Stern, and I am here to moderate this group of amazing sports marketing experts. We have folks from the Marlins, the Dolphins, the Heat, and the Orange Bowl. And we are going to talk about the technology that goes into sports marketing today. It's really evolved very rapidly over the last 5 years, and I can tell you that the Dolphins have been at the forefront of technology and sports for several years, and the Heat have caught up rapidly. They have a brand new app that they've been working on for the last year and a half. And of course, the Marlins are supported by Major League Baseball. Major League Baseball has been very forward thinking with its technology applications. So unlike the other two leagues, it's really more up to baseball, and the Marlins implement it, and they have in their brand new stadium. And of course, we're gonna discuss with our representative from the Orange Bowl what they are doing for their big game each year. So I'm gonna hand the mic over to everybody to introduce yourselves.
Great. Hi everyone, thank you guys for having us today. I'm Christina Ramos from the Orange Bowl, thanks again.
Hey, Joe Cervone from Miami Marlins, I'm their digital marketing manager.
How you doing? My name is Vince Pinozo, I'm with the Miami Dolphins.
Hey everybody, my name is Cedric Brown. I am the interactive marketing content manager for the Miami Heat.
Yes, yes, I know. There's only one microphone, so there's going to be a little bit of passing around. So to start with, I'm going to ask a few questions, and then at the end, I will open up the floor to all of your questions, and I do mean all of them. So I'd like to ask each of you, what is the number one new technology initiative for your organization this year?
Great. So we're working on a lot of stuff with Facebook and Ticketmaster. I guess they've been working on the event enhancements and features that Facebook is offering. So now the sports consumer can actually purchase their tickets directly through Facebook. When the event button pops up, you can see purchase tickets now. So that's an interesting call we've had. And then we're also continuing our discussions with Snapchat. We've had a lot of success there nationally, internationally. So we look forward to doing that.
Yeah, for us, it's mobile ticketing. We're in our second year. Along with the Marlins, the other 29 MLB clubs, each of us have our ballpark application, which you're able to have your tickets uploaded right through there. If you're a single game or a season ticket holder, you're able to forward, you're able to share them to a family or friends instantaneously at the gate, use the barcode, go right through, donate, sell them back on the secondary market. We've seen a lot of success with that. However, the next point for us is point of sale. So integrating all of our systems in our ballpark, retail, concessions and whatnot. You've seen Starbucks, you've seen Disney with their Magic Band. When you make it more accessible in your point of sale systems to make purchases, you see greater ROI.
I'll take that. You guys can share one.
Well, we're in the process of pretty much opening up a brand new stadium. So what we've done over the past few years is enhance our mobile app to get ready for that experience. And what we're focused on this year is moving season ticket members from a ticket experience 3 years ago to a card experience, now to a digital-first experience. In addition, we're enhancing our beacon technology and integrating it with pretty much anything that you could see around the stadium, whether it be our point of sale or the user experience from arriving at the stadium to departure.
And this year at the Heat, two of our biggest initiatives will be mobile ticketing. So I guess kind of piggyback off of the Marlins a little bit.
Keep it close there, man, so they can hear you.
Okay. So like Grant said, this is last year we launched a brand new mobile app. And we're going to have a relaunch here in a few weeks with a bunch of fixes and kind of like a new look, makeover. And one of our internal goals is to be, 100% mobile ticketing. If not by the end of next season, going into the following season after that, because people just don't use paper anymore. So we kind of want to get there. And one other thing we're focused on this year is the launch of our new retail website, the MiamiHeatStore.com. I think September 30th is when that will go live, and we have a lot of new intricacies that will hopefully help us push more retail sales.
So Cedric, hang on to the microphone there, because I'm going to ask you the next question first. So you guys actually pioneered ticketless ticketing, let's call it, digital ticketing. Before the Marlins were doing it with Major League, before the Dolphins did it with the cards, like you mentioned, the Heat moved to that system. What drove them to jump into that early? It was right around the time of the lockout, like about 4 or 5 years ago.
Well, I think the biggest thing that pushed us to that was obviously the success that our team was having on the court. You know, there's no better time to strike than when you're winning. So we had that.
That's a great point. So in other words, fans' attitudes towards trying these new things that might not work quite as well as the old thing. I mean, tickets are old-fashioned. They've been working for 100 years plus. So you're saying that actually success on the field helped you guys experiment?
Absolutely, because to piggyback off of what you just said, we noticed that fans hate change, and I'm sure you all see the exact same thing. They hate it. They hate change. So it's a lot easier to, you know, push a mobile app to a fan who's been using paper tickets for the last 20 years when they come to see a great product on the floor.
So let's speak with Vince. So what challenges have the Dolphins faced in particular in building this new stadium? Because it's not just about building something that's on the field or in the stands. You guys have actually rebuilt the entire, like the office areas. I mean, everything is located there at the stadium. So what was the number one challenge when you're dealing with the fans in this massive, massive overhaul of the Dolphins franchise?
Well, one of the major components of the new stadium and the renovation, it was a three-year process. So there was construction going on during the seasons. Majority of it did take place between January and July of each year. During the off-season.
It would have been better from February to July. Let the team know that.
I'll let Coach know. The hardest part for us internally is that we look at our stadium, and especially now, as like a global entertainment and destination. So, you know, the Canes play there 10 games a year. The Orange Bowl is there on one, possibly 2 to 3 days a year, whether it's college football playoffs and national championship games and the Orange Bowl. And we're there for 10 to hopefully 13 days a year as well, then the Super Bowl. We're looking to fill the other, you know, 300 days of that year with other events. So that was a major challenge for us, is looking at ways that we were able to, have that experience and, you know, drive revenue from not being able to host events there. The other major challenge for us was being able to show people what the stadium was going to look like without actually having people be able to go to the stadium because it was a construction site.
So I really appreciated the shade maps that you guys handed out. Those were pretty outstanding. How'd you guys do those?
So
showed like where the shade would be if you bought a ticket once the roof is up.
We worked closely with our architecture firm to develop those shade maps, but we also worked closely with IO Media and other partners to develop, and Samsung, to use gear headsets to actually show the experience within the stadium and various spaces within the stadium without taking people there. So we used a lot of Facebook advertising to drive people to come out and take a virtual tour of the stadium, and thus be able to have our salesperson deliver them and show them the premium areas that we were developing at the stadium, and also the view from what their new seat would be looking like with the shaded canopy.
Great. So, Joseph, you're up. You're on the hot seat.
Okay.
So how does it work between the Marlins and Major League Baseball? Because unlike the other sports leagues, Major League Baseball takes a much bigger role in the technology of its teams. And in fact, Major League Baseball provides two reporters for each team, for each game, correct? Where there's like a road reporter and a home reporter for actually each game, right?
Yeah, Major League Baseball is a great parent, I would say. Grant's mentioned before, they for a long time have been on the forefront of a lot of technologies. Their at-bat app for following games, whether you have an MLB TV subscription or you're just looking at the pitch-by-pitch results, I think has been, they've been ahead of the curve, pun intended. They basically, I realized, I think, a long time ago that they had 15 games every single night, 162 games a year. Our season is significantly longer than most sports teams. And they became the pioneers of live stream technology to the point where, you know, they work now with companies like WWE. They work with Netflix, which is pretty exciting to be a part of, knowing that our fans, whether they're in Miami, whether in their Japan and their Marlins and Ichiro Suzuki fans, they're able to live stream everywhere. And that goes as well with our in-stadium experience, too, through our ballpark app. You know, mobile ticketing, we've been on the forefront for, but we...
Right. So I was wondering, how do you guys get Major League Baseball to adapt all of that to the local sphere? How do you take it from this national operation and bring it into Miami, and how do you customize that?
Yeah, they're really, I think for them, they view us as kind of one of their guinea pigs in that we're a market that's unlike a lot of other ones. And they're sensitive to the fact that every market of the 30 teams is different. You know, Hispanic and Latin followership is really important. And actually today they're kicking off their Hispanic Heritage Month. They're putting the accent on top of their logo if you look on many of their other teams and MLB's accounts. And Miami is one of the premier markets for doing that. So they're pretty good at helping each market, I think, cater to their specific audience.
Okay, great. And Christina, you run a mostly it's a one-day large event, but you guys also run a basketball tournament, right?
Yep.
You guys run a lot of junior events.
Yep.
How do you guys leverage technology to get more attention across all the different Orange Bowl events? Because obviously the football event attracts most attention. But how many events do you guys manage each year?
So our portfolio of events, we have over 100 annually. So from stand-up paddleboard tournaments to the basketball classic that you mentioned, we're getting involved in lacrosse.
I just started stand-up paddleboarding, so you'll have to send
me
that one.
Oh, yeah, you got it. We got it. We'll put the GoPro on you. It's pretty interesting. You know, everybody's talked about their apps for their facilities. We also created one to kind of keep all of our events, you know, all in one place. Let the traveling fans know, you know, what's going on and if they are back in Miami to check the app for all their information. In terms of other technology, we do have somewhat of a challenge because most of our social media followers and our digital fans are really football fans. So we do struggle quite a bit with trying to make sure that our football fans in Oklahoma don't get bored about hearing about our local Miami, Florida events. So
that is a challenge.
Oh yeah, for sure.
And we are going to talk about social media with these teams because that's a big topic in athletics. There's a lot of obviously topics in athletics and, you know, free expression. So we'll get there.
Yeah, sure.
But how do you guys manage that? How do you keep the Oklahomans or the Iowans, the people around the country who are interested in the national football game interested, but still serve the local market?
Right. So we really make an effort to stay relevant year round. You know, our teams aren't picked till December and then the game happens 20 days after. So that's really our hot window. We've started to recognize and lean on our history, our traditions, our greats. So from recognizing NFL players who played in our games, wishing them a happy birthday, tagging ESPN, focusing on college mascots, their coaches, their athletic associations, we've had a lot of success, as well as relying on our partners. So ESPN will, you know, make sure they're featuring us every now and again when it's slow time, as well as the ACC and SEC, Big Ten, and Notre Dame. So we've been pretty successful thus far.
Okay, well, that's pretty cool. And it's difficult because it's very different running one large event with subsidiary events versus having a franchise and a schedule and, you know, and everybody else marketing towards that. There's no help from the Fiesta Bowl, for example. So let's turn our attention to social media. And you really answered a lot of the questions I might ask you. So I'm going to hand it over to Joseph and we'll kind of keep going this way. But as we all know, social media and athletics have become intertwined because Twitter and Facebook and Snapchat and Instagram give athletes an opportunity to interact with the fans. And of course, it gives the fans the opportunity to interact with the athletes and additionally with the teams. Now, I can tell you that just from the beginning of this panel, you guys heard about one of the major challenges from Cedric, which is that not every team is doing so well all the time. And I like to think of it like this bottle of Repel. You know, once in a while, like, I want to get romantic with my wife, but I'm wearing this Repel here. How do you do that? How do you manage a team that may have some perception problems in public, but you still have a social media presence and you still have to react and respond to your fans? How do the Marlins manage that, Joseph?
Yeah, you know, that's a great question, Grant. And, you know, in every league, not unique to just baseball, you know, at the end of the season, only one team's fan base goes home happy with a happy ending. You know, the rest end up, you know, waiting till next year, you know, as Cub fans like to say. And, you know, they're good now, but, you know, it's still early.
Well, clearly they have mastered the art of marketing without winning on the field. But now, as I understand it, Major League Baseball controls the team's official account. Is that correct?
Not exactly. They're exactly. A partner. You know, they're certainly involved in the strategy and the day-to-day operation, but each team has the opportunity to kind of drive the strategy and drive the content that you see. And to answer your question from beginning, I think it's just a matter of being genuine and authentic. You know, when your team doesn't do well or you're having a season that's not going well, fans are looking for you to authentically show that you're not satisfied with it, showing that in the office, in the dugout, in the owner's office, that, they want to win just as much as the fans do. And, as digital storytellers, not every chapter is going to be a great one. So you have to be authentic and true. And I think fans respond to that.
So do you respond to some of the critics or the trolls even? Or do you guys take the higher road and not respond to some of these folks?
Sure. I would say it's a case-by-case basis. I think very often when your season, in terms of wins and losses, isn't going particularly well, there's always an opportunity to kind of shine a bright light. So, in the case of the Marlins a few years ago, they had a lot of young, up-and-coming talent that was arising in outfielders like Giancarlo Stanton, Christian Yelich, pitcher Jose Fernandez. And, we got to tell that story that there is a strategy and that there is a plan in place, and that sometimes watching young talent emerge and then get to that level of success that fans are always striving to see is kind of a fun thing to watch. There's always an opportunity, I think, to show fans that there's a plan in place and that there's better days and better games coming.
Do you guys actually take the social media feedback that you get and bring it all the way to the top?
I wish. I think our baseball ops guys would probably shoo me out of the office if I came in there telling them what player our fans wanted to trade or sign.
Well, I'm not talking about necessarily on the field. I think that everybody has an opinion. Everybody wants to be a Monday morning quarterback. But I'm talking about for the fan experience. When there's a problem with the fan experience, do those tweets fly up to the upper reaches of the Marlins office?
Absolutely. When we are always monitoring in-game, and which is a challenge in itself because we play an 81-game schedule, we have a dedicated
81 home games, right?
81 home games, and then 162 games. We every single home game have a dedicated person who is monitoring our social media for fan customer questions. And one example I like to give is, although we don't have the roof open very much, we had an early game last year where a fan was sitting in fair territory where the roof was completely open and they were exposed, and they had a bird fly over them, and I could
do what birds do,
right? And we saw it, and we saw them post about it and say that they truthfully didn't have a very negative tone, but we sent it up the ladder to our customer service team, and we brought them a Marlins t-shirt, and they immediately posted about it and gave us kudos. And that's the power of social. People want to see that you're listening to them, and it doesn't take much to make a little action like that for someone to really have a lasting experience and memory about our team and our brand. So that's the power of listening and acting.
It is. Thank you, Joseph. Vincent, you guys have a very different situation than the Marlins. Not just on the field and not just with the ownership, but let me just explain that the Dolphins actually changed the front office. It was almost like a trade. Did you come over in the trade?
I did not.
No,
I was here for both.
Okay, you were here for both. It was it's very unusual, but it was kind of like a trade where the San Diego Padres front office kind of came over here in our former front office went out to San Diego, including the president, Mike D. So what have you guys done to change the way that you handle social media from back then when the team was more concerned about the orange carpet and other things, Jimmy Buffett songs, things that were not so popular, to today? Because it seems like there's a lot more listening going on today than under the Mike D administration.
I didn't oversee social back at that time,
sure.
So I kind of started.
Effects are good too. I'd like to know the effects.
The effects started taking took this role over when the changes kind of actually started coming about. The big thing that we've made a large emphasis on, especially with Tom, our CEO, and from ownership with Stephen Ross, Mr. Ross is invested in technology companies. I mean, if you see like the Drone Racing League, which just signed a big deal with ESPN. He's a major investor in the Drone Racing League. If you've ever heard of Gary Vaynerchuk, he and Gary Vaynerchuk are partners in VaynerMedia and RSE Vayner, which is a hedge fund for startups. So Mr. Ross is extremely in the weeds with emerging technology, data, and is a big proponent of what we're doing. And that trickles down to our CEO, who you know, he's constantly on Twitter, seeing what we're doing, pushing the envelope, having us push the envelope in terms of what we're capable of doing. And I think one of the big effects of that is that we're focused on the quality of content that we're putting out. We know that, you know, our community size is a number that we personally don't really look at this time, because we know that's relates more back to wins and losses, and we really can't control that. But what we can control is the content, the quality, the views, the impressions that we put out. And we probably have to put in a lot larger effort to get those numbers that we want to reach and get to, but we are able to do that with the help of our creative team. One other thing that we've done too since that time is we've brought our creative team completely in-house. So we have our
own. That's a big change, actually.
It's a major change. It started when Mike was here, but our creative director, Surf Melendez, is the old creative director for Adidas North America. Came over, so a lot of his influence is there, as well as our photographer and director, or senior director of photography and video, who came over from the Arizona Diamondbacks. So he worked with Tom way back in the day. So he spearheaded, you know, changing the look and feel of everything. And what we've really focused on is, you know, we don't really look at ourselves as a sports team. I always kind of say I don't work for a sports team. I work for a digital agency who's my biggest client just happens to be the Miami Dolphins, and that I'm stationed within Hard Rock Stadium.
Wait a minute. Hillary Clinton didn't hire you guys? She took your Stronger Together slogan.
I know. Oh, that's true, too. We did phase that out over time. But, you know, we look at the storytelling that we try to do, and it's, you know, wins or losses, it's content that we're going to be able to push out. No matter how success is on or off the field, we made a big switch to these music campaign videos that we've been pushing out this year. And they're all of our campaign strategy is really Facebook first in terms of, you know, the maximum amount of reach that we get and targeting, and then it all relates back to business objectives that we do with retargeting of ads, for single game tickets, season tickets, for sponsorship. But what we've done that we never did before is, you know, we've taken our marketing budget and we bought music rights to various songs, whether it be Ray Charles songs. And, you know, we're not making content like you'd see from a normal sports team where it's like your typical hype video going into something. We're doing something where, you know, we had a video with Jarvis Landry coming out of the tunnel to Mr. Bojangles, which is a slow, very, like, calming song. And, you know, it ends with he jumps so high and it's making a great one-handed catch. But it's like, it's making you think. It's like, okay, this is not content that a sports team does. What's going on here? So we're trying to attract that casual fan, too, where we're getting into the arts. You know, we worked with artists from Wynwood to design helmets for us last year, and we're doing lots of projects with Wynwood artists now as well. So it's taking a different approach to what a sports team does in terms of content to kind of broaden our reach, but then also capitalize on hopeful success that's coming soon.
It's very different. It's really night and day. I had season tickets about 5 years ago to the Miami Dolphins, and then I let them lapse, and then I picked them up again last year, and they were memberships. Right? It's not a season ticket anymore. It's a membership. So let's turn to Cedric, because he feels left out there, all the way on the end by himself, with all those championship trophies in the team's case. So, you know, with the Heat, it's a whole other situation, because the Heat went from, you know, beloved to all of a sudden a global phenomenon, right around the time that you arrived, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, it's perfect timing for me.
So, how did you guys handle the overnight change from being local to being global and dealing with social media from around the world? Because it's a little bit different, right?
Oh, absolutely. Like you say, before the Big Three came about, we're just dealing with the South Floridians, that fan base. After that, like you said, we're global. We have a ton of fans in the Philippines and overseas and Asia, this and that we weren't used to dealing with. So we go out and we create heat.com/China and heatinespanol.com.
Wait, what.com with China?
Heat.com.
Heat.com/China. Yeah, okay, yeah. Gotcha.
So, I mean, we just had to open up, invest in foreign affairs, so to say, and just
how
roll
many people
with it.
Did you guys bring in to manage social media? How big is the team there?
Well, the team now is at 5. Before the Big Three, it was 2.
Wow.
So
it's a big expansion.
Right. It doesn't sound like a lot, but it definitely is. 3 extra people, 3 extra bodies to kind of help out and now we're in a different space.
Yeah.
Like I say, it's... Oh, go ahead. What did I say?
Well, let's talk about controversy in sports and how social media is very much involved in transmitting it. And, you know, sometimes it's a controversial tweet. Sometimes an athlete does something controversial and then publishes it on Twitter, or they do something controversial and then the conversation goes online afterwards. I think everybody is thinking about one particular incident right now, but it is not the first. It is actually simply one of many. When it happens, like, for example, with Colin Kaepernick, people always react as if it's the first time a sports figure has ever spoken out about politics or the real world. But let's face it, it happens probably to every team once a year in some way, shape, or form. And with the Heat, it's no exception. Just as an example, I was writing an article. I'm actually a columnist, and I write for a couple of national journals like OccupyDemocrats.com and PhotographyIsNotACrime.com, and I wrote one for Occupy Democrats, and we mentioned the Trayvon Martin incident. And actually, the entire Miami Heat team made a statement and pushed it onto LeBron James's Twitter account, where it was seen by millions and millions of people. So what do the Heat do to manage the controversies that come up, or the controversial statements that athletes might make, like LeBron's statement, which in retrospect doesn't seem so controversial, but at the time it was actually quite a controversial statement?
Right, well, in cases like that, you kind of let the players do what the players want to do there. I mean, we definitely have their back, but we're not going to jump on one side of the fence or the other, because we're the organization. They're the player. They speak for themselves. We speak for the organization as a whole. So it's a little tougher there. But it also depends on the actual controversy, because one controversy I'd say that we've been dealing with, not controversy, but it's the elephant in the room, that we lost, you know, our guy this summer, Dwayne Wade. So when you lose a player like that, he's not just any other free agent to depart. I mean, you got Dwayne Wade, Kobe, Dirk Nowitzki, Tim Duncan, like those kind
of
guys. Like,
yeah,
the
faces
Heat
of the franchise,
that
sure.
We like to say. And when he departs, what do? You attack it head on. You know, you deal with it with your fan base. Our owner, Mickey Arison, he published a letter kind of describing what happened. Pat Riley took to the podium shortly afterwards. He explained from his standpoint why we're in this situation now, and you move on. And we gave our Dwayne Wade fan appreciation. We have fans that are happy about it. We have fans that are still upset about it. But we move on now. We have a brand new team, and like I say, it is what it is. Like, we've signed guys that people have never heard of. But it is my job to make sure that in a month you know who Willie Reed is, you know, because we have to keep going as a team. So, like I said, it just depends on the actual controversy. Like, some are more serious than others, and you just kind of have to tiptoe the line, and others, you have the ability to attack it head on.
Great. Let's hand it over to Vincent. You're on the hot seat. No, I mean, I think it's great, because of all of the NFL sports team owners, the first one to support the players in protesting was?
Stephen Ross.
Right, your boss. So, I mean, I think we've gotten a very good example of how the Miami Dolphins handle crisis management in, you know, with the players. But can you give me any perspective about how they handle just the gaffes? Because there have been gaffes by Dolphins players over the last 5 years. There's been domestic violence issues. We all know about Laremy Tunsil with the draft issue. Is there an organizational philosophy at play? Is there something that you guys all have in mind when it comes to dealing with social media and the crisis moments that come up?
The key, I guess, around crisis moments, the Laremy Tunsil one was kind of interesting, because it happened so fast on draft night, where we didn't even know, you know, we were drafting him, and then all of a sudden he fell into our lap and we picked him, and then so we're going with our normal draft strategy.
It's draft night. Everybody is watching. All of a sudden, video comes out. Are you guys familiar with this story? Yeah, okay. And then all of a sudden they say, let's take him. But did they have a plan in place for dealing with the fallout?
We did. I think the most crucial element of it is the communication strategy amongst internally, and then following through externally. So in a lot of these situations, it's a very tight group of people that will start communicating, whether it be, ideally it's in person, but a lot of time it might need to be over a phone or email, depending upon where people are located. And it's bringing in various key stakeholders from various parties on how we're going to communicate messages. So it's our Senior Vice President of Communications, Jason Jenkins, who is my direct boss, our CMO, Jeremy Walls, our President and CEO, Tom Garfinkel. It's a lot of communication between those parties where, you know, it's open communication so that we know what the message is going to be to the public. And then from there, it's also disseminating the information to within the organization so that we're all on the same page. There's a lot of moving parts that go on behind the scenes so that we don't necessarily, we don't want to jump too soon on something when we don't have all the facts. So there's a lot of fact-finding before a decision is made one way or another.
Sure. I mean, you guys, I think, have had to deal with more, like, crisis management issues than I think any of the other two, you know, organizations that are represented here today. And I do want to commend the Dolphins for having, let's say, grown as a franchise. Because, as we all may recall, at least I recall, there was a time when even the owner was like, hey, I didn't realize that ESPN was going to be tracking where my plane lands. So, Joseph, let's move along, because the Marlins have a very unique problem with crisis management in social media, which is that it tends to be, I think, even more often on a local level, not so much. I mean, the Dolphins have had some national controversies, but the Dolphins have had a lot more local issues. And most recently, there was a report that there was a lawsuit between the team and one of the season ticket owners. How do you guys handle a crisis when it comes in, when that New Times article comes out and it's slamming the team, and that's pretty much all they write, so it's a couple times a year? How do you guys handle it?
Sure. You know, I actually will echo a lot of what Vince said. When something like that happens, there is a time where our executives from our PR, our baseball information, and all the way up to our team president, you know, everyone meets together and we get on the same page and we find out, you know, why has something been written? You know, what's the background behind it? And you know, what is our response to it? And, you know, from team president all the way on down to, you know, interns and part-time staff, you know, there's, I think, really good communication internally about, you know, what's happening, why it happened, and, you know, what is our response? You know, in the case of something like that, I would really rather say that as an organization, I think we do a really good job of showcasing why it is great to be a season ticket holder. The Marlins have probably one of the most robust and forward-thinking loyalty programs of any sports team out there right now. I challenge most sports teams to find and create a program where you get as much benefit in terms of events, in terms of the opportunity to use points that you earn just by watching a game or coming to a game and using your tickets on memorabilia, on experiences like traveling with team, playing golf with spring training. And social media for that is an incredible tool because we're able to showcase that this season ticket holder program that we've put together, this loyalty program, is really cool. And it extends beyond just wins and losses and what goes on the field. And that's a really exciting thing for me because we get to showcase a lot of really fun things that we do with our season ticket holders.
Very cool, very cool. So let's move on to the next topic. I know that's one, you know, it's a little bit different having an event. What is your favorite Orange Bowl from online to offline experience, where you guys have communicated or met somebody through social media, and then met them in person? Gone from online to offline, it's just a...
Yeah, I would tie it back to your previous question about controversy, and you used the term trolls, which we have lots of those, believe it or not.
I'm not surprised.
So we actually find those angry, disgruntled fans as opportunities to turn them into our biggest fan. And whether it's reporters in other states or local reporters who maybe don't understand the new college football playoff, we really do. We take all of our tweets, all of the social content that fans are putting out there, and we're fortunate enough to where we probably have a little more time on our hands with less than a full season.
That's true. It's not as much of a day-to-day grind, but it's still coming in every day.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, with the example of the Dolphins and the whole Anthem incident, we actually were tied into a couple of the tweets where people were blaming us for certain things. One fan called us pricks because of the way we treat our volunteers and, I mean, yada, 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 yada. So we actually learned more about this fan. He's actually a professor at one of the local universities who supplies student volunteers to our organization.
Sounds like an opportunity and a necessity to deal with as well.
So we reached out to him, and we're talking to him about his student experience and what makes us pricks, if you will. we've also experienced certain campaigns online where you mentioned a great word over there. You said it's not just your strategy, but it's how you activate. And during Bowl Week, we do a lot of giveaways. I guess a couple years ago when we were just a one-man show, we forgot to mail someone a helmet. And when I tell you that for 2 years straight, every single post that we posted, this gentleman trolled us to no avail. I actually took on the social media, and he was the first phone call I made. He was shocked that I reached him at his office in North Carolina because his social media profile said he worked at ESPN in Cleveland. And, you know, again, now he's our biggest fan. He writes posts saying how great we are.
Every day?
Not every day, once a month. You know, he begged us not to tell his wife, which was pretty funny. But again, you know, it's all about making those opportunities. And with the sports writers as well, we'll invite him out to lunch and tell him, hey, you know, that article you wrote, that piece you wrote, it's wrong because X, Y, and Z. You know, give us a call next time. We're happy to give you input, factual information on how we can make, you know, your stories better and your information a little more factual. So we enjoy the challenge.
That's great.
Yeah.
Joseph, same question to you. What's your best online to offline experience? You told us one of them. Got any more to add? Because I know that there's a lot of trolls that are out there after the Marlins. So. But there's a lot of activity. I mean, you know, it doesn't matter that they're trolling. What matters is that people care. If people just do not care about what you are doing on social media and online, you failed. I mean, before you answer, I'll just tell you, I have one troll on my personal Facebook page, which now has like 10,000 people following, but this guy has to troll every single post. And people said to me, why do you leave this guy on there? He's driving me batshit. And I said, you know, he stirs up conversation.
No, I mean, from our standpoint, like I mentioned before, on an in-game standpoint, we always are having a dedicated person who's listening to our social media for those customer service instances, like the bird and the T-shirt.
Like the bird.
Or when we have a bobblehead day, like we've had each of our Saturday home games, and someone opens one up for their child, and you know the bobblehead unfortunately broke. We see that, and we quickly activate our customer service team to respond to it.
Have you ever had a time where a fan reaches out to the player in a special circumstance, and they... you know, the team helps facilitate that? Or should they just reach out to the player? Because I'm sure they reach out to you guys as much as they do the player.
Well, for sure. And I think having fans and our players interact on social is what you want. You know, folks want to be able to access their players. The fact that all of them are on these major platforms and you can just quickly reply or ask them a question is something that older generations never had that availability. You know, on our standpoint, you know, we're a resource and a tool to our players. You know, if they have questions about attention that they want from fans, unwanted attention, if they need help getting a blue check mark on their account, if they have philanthropy that they need supported, you know, we're there to support them and answer any questions. And I'm sure all these folks up on the stage have built strong relationships with their players with the intention that these guys know that we're there to make them look like superstars, not just digitally, but, you know, in every way that we can support them.
Great. Vincent?
I think... going back to last year was our 50th season. We launched this campaign called our Since Moment campaign. So it was asking fans to tell us that moment that they fell in love with the team. It's like not necessarily a play on the field, but like what was that moment when it was your grandfather gave you a Dolphins hat or a pennant or you got a little toy when you went to the drive-thru when you were 5 years old and all of a sudden you're a Dolphins fan for life.
That's really poignant. And I'll tell you, it reminds me of this one study, this neuromarketing study. They compared like Coke and Pepsi, you know, this famous study actually. Which tastes better, Coke or Pepsi? Coke? Anybody? Pepsi? No? Well, okay, you're a Pepsi guy. So we have two Coke, one Pepsi. Well, what they found was that in a blind taste test, people preferred Pepsi. But if they knew what it was, they preferred Coke. And then years and years later, somebody did a fMRI study, and they found that the region of the brain that was activated when people were drinking Coke, it's the memory region.
So
keep going. I just had to interrupt you there for that. That's a cool campaign. I like that.
So we launched the campaign in May, I want to say, of last 2015. And one of the first videos that we did is, you know, we were basically just asking, like, hey, tell us your sense moment. And we had an aggregation website of people tweeting us photos. And, you know, they were coming in constantly throughout the course of the year. It's like, oh, you know, memories. But one guy reached out to us and told us, like, hey, you know, in that video, one of the opening scenes of the videos, and it wasn't a normal, it was the same type of storytelling video that I was talking about earlier. There was a five-year-old that received a football from Dan Marino, and I think it was Duper, right before one of the games in the Orange Bowl. And he was 5 years old. His uncle had brought him down there for his fifth birthday. And he wrote us a letter. So he told us, he was like, hey, you know, like, I saw that video. It's amazing. I just wanted to let you know how that moment impacted my life. I ended up, you know, going to Princeton and going to law school. Now I have a law firm up in New Jersey or something like that. So we were like, oh, wow, that's amazing. So what we did is we flew him back down to South Florida when we had our Finns Weekend Fishing and Golf Tournament. And, you know, we were interviewing him about that because we were like, oh, tell us your story. But at that same time, we had Dan and the guys surprise him with another football and
that's
relive
awesome.
That moment again, like, you know, 30 years later, which was a really cool and special moment for us. So we're constantly looking for, I guess, ways to connect with the fan that aren't usual. So it's the same thing. We're going to be having a new series that we're going to be launching here in the upcoming weeks that you'll see. And it's the same thing. It's going to be very emotional storytelling. But the first one is about a gentleman. His daughter reached out to us a couple weeks ago, or maybe a couple late July, reached out to us, told us, you know, my father's old. He has cancer. He's probably going to die within the year. We bought him tickets to the preseason game up in New Jersey because they live in Philadelphia.
Sure.
Huge Dolphins fan. Has never been to a game in his life.
Let me interrupt you again. There's a surprising number of Dolphins fans in the Northeast, an actually large group. Continue.
And so what we did is, you know, we went up there a couple days early and we brought him up to the stadium, you know, to give him a kind of a VIP experience at that day. Got to introduce him to some people. He actually had, unfortunately, his sister passed away the day before the game as well. So it was a really rough time, but we're hopefully going to be able to tell his story and tell a story of fandom pretty soon here. But, you know, looking at those ways that people make connections with a team, more so than based on wins and losses, but there's that strong connection, and it goes across all sports of, you know, you're not really going to ever remember 20 years ago, you know, other than winning the championship or a major game, but you're probably going to remember being there with your dad or being there with your best friends or tailgate out in the parking lot, and it's looking at it more than just 60 minutes of football. It's looking at it as a lifestyle, as a passion, and, you know,
experience.
Making those connections for life.
Thank you. That's great. Cedric? Tough act to follow.
Oh, I know. Actually,
but, I mean, the Heat, I think, have quite a few of these, so.
Right. Well, us at the Heat, just like these guys, we are super dedicated to customer service. That's our number one thing on the business side because, as we like to say, we can't control what happens on the court, but outside of those four lines, we can in some capacity or another. So, like I say, just like the Marlins here, we have people who monitor all of our mentions all the time, especially during games. And, you know, unless you're yelling at me to give Hassan Whiteside more minutes, which I can't do, I can probably fix whatever you're complaining to me about. If you're at the game and you spilled your soda or this concession stand was too long, we can fix that, and we'll try our best to do so. Like I say, we get messages all day long on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter with different stories. And if people are complaining, we won't address it publicly. Like, I don't like to, you know, tweet people back. We'll take it privately into, you know, direct messages, things like that, and see what's going on, what can we fix. Over the summer, one of the biggest things we did was, and I hate to keep harping on this, but after we lost Dwayne, a father sent us a nice lengthy message on Facebook saying his 9-year-old daughter, they lived out in Washington, outside of Seattle, about 2 hours outside of Seattle in a small town. So,
very
hey, my
small
daughter,
town out there.
Yeah, I feel like it. I didn't go, but I heard it was very small.
Yeah.
So, hey, my daughter is, you know, she's a huge Dwayne fan. She's been crying ever since this happened. Can you please send her a T-shirt? Can you please do something just, you know, to help me help her? It's like, okay, we'll send you a T-shirt. What we ended up doing was we found out her 9th birthday party was coming up, so we sent our mascot, Bernie, all the way out there.
That's
surprised
cool.
her and everything, and she was so happy from the video that we saw and things like that. So if we can, you know, make someone's day, it may cost a little money, but we're going to do what we can to do it because, like I said, we can control what happens outside the white lines, not inside the white lines. We want to, you know, build a fan base from the ground up. Like, you know, if you come to a game and we lose by 30, we want you to come back because you had a great time watching us lose by 30. You know what I mean? And
luckily, that hasn't happened a lot lately.
Yet.
So I'm going to turn the floor over to the audience. Anybody have questions? Okay.
Hi. Okay, so I'm just curious to hear from all of you guys, like, what your strategy is for community management, like, trolls aside, especially during the games. You know, like, is there a tactic for, like, liking, following, commenting, retweeting, etc., with fans during the events?
Well,
okay,
specifically,
in-game and content-based, not necessarily online to offline, but how do you guys decide what to like, what to retweet? Is there a guideline or is it spontaneous?
Well, speaking on behalf of the Heat, we love to control the conversation during games because we have 82 regular season games. That's a lot, and things can, you know, run together. Dunks and three-pointers look the same after a while, so every game has a storyline at some point built in. So if someone is tweeting us about, hey, this guy's on fire, we'll tweet back, yeah, you're right, he is. What else do you want to see him do? Something to engage the conversation, keep people interested. And, I mean, if you check out, you know, most of our timelines, Twitter, Instagram, we'll jump in the comments for pictures, things like that. And we just want to, you know, go back and forth. We want to speak to you and have you speak back to us. That's how we control it.
Go ahead, Vincent.
That is one thing that, you know, as hopefully as our team expands more, that we're going to be able to do a better job at. On game days, you know, we're focused on trying to control the content and then also monitoring for, you know, at home games, we have a larger team that will monitor issues or challenges at the stadium. We developed like a Hard Rock Stadium guest experience account to jump into those conversations. So we know where to look for those comments, where they're mostly coming from. And, you know, they'll generally be directed at the stadium or our CEO. So we're able to interject until they're...
Certainly, there's quite a few comments directed at those folks, I'm sure.
Exactly. So we like to interject in there before it becomes an issue and before we get emailed from him saying, can you guys route it? So, but we'd like to keep that conversation going. Now, it's difficult, like, it's a little bit harder on some game days for us, too, where, you know, we're trying to publish to five different platforms at once, coming up with the post-game strategy. You know, we only have 16 days a year where we were playing that actually matter, that we know that are going to matter.
How many people are on the game day social media team?
They're, in terms of distributing content, it's just myself.
Okay.
In terms of developing content, we do have a broad range of teams. So, for instance, when we were in Seattle, we had it was a little bit heavier a load because we were out there doing a story for another one of the pieces that we're doing. But
okay.
We probably will bring two videographers with us, and they're also editors.
Those guys are for later, though, right? Videographer,
well,
or are they live streaming as well?
No, what we've tried to do is now we're in the process of we're capturing content to distribute in almost real time and
okay.
Cut up and edit. So if you saw yesterday or Sunday's game, we put out, a piece that was developed over 3 days there about our time in Seattle. And then we also put out two videos that were completely shot and produced and then edited and cut up and before kickoff. So what we want to do is we want to create content to be able to tell that story on the day of the game. We're not focused on developing content for later because like we don't know what's
sure.
Going to happen after the game. We have a kind of like a win plan, a loss plan, but we have to develop everything that, you know, up to kickoff we can control. After that, it's go with
it.
The flow.
Yeah.
And then afterwards, you know, we go either route A or route B. And at the same time, it's also what we could capture from those moments. And, you know, it's tough where pregame it's like, okay, I know I'm going to get this pump-up speech to distribute on social. It's one of the most engaging things that the fans do. Okay, you know what, this season they decided not to do it. All right, let me go get the defensive line one instead. Okay, they're swearing, and I can't push that out on social.
It's also different because maybe more like the Orange Bowl, but unlike the Marlins and the Heat, every game for the Dolphins is nationally televised, whereas the Miami Heat have a lot of local games and a percentage that are nationally televised, and the Marlins have a smaller percentage that are nationally televised. But even still, having a longer season means even a national television game is not going to bring the kind of intense focus that one of 16. You know, you have 10 times as many games, you have 1/10 the people seeing them, but it's still the same amount of people over the course of the long year. Joseph, what do you guys do on game day to decide if you're going to reshare content or when to interact?
Yeah, the strategy is twofold. First, it's to create content that is remarkable. And we say remarkable, we want you to create content that people are going to share with. The second part is building community. You know, to answer your question, a share or, you know, replying with a funny GIF, which if you look at our Twitter account, that's what we do in game. We're the type of brand that we don't speak at you, we speak to you and we speak with you. And that's free. You know, there's no cost to our organization, our brand, other than just our time and our attention. And I would say often our fans are very savvy. The comments they make on social media, the observations, we use those to play off of, to help tell the story. Because isn't that what you want? You want your fans to be talking about your brand, even better than at times you can yourself. So for us, it's just active listening and working off of our fans.
And just for you, did you guys inspire Marlon Man, or does Marlon Man inspire you guys?
No, Marlon's Man, I'm not sure where he came from, but he is his own entity. But we appreciate and are happy to have him. You know, he represents Marlon's Red Orange everywhere he goes, and he's a great fan.
And he is everywhere.
He truly is.
Christina, how many people do you guys have on game day for social media?
So we'll have a team of about 6, and that's that we'll bring in some freelancers on game day. And we actually have it divided up into the types of comments. So there's the customer service comments, there's the disgruntled folks, there's the TV audience who they get really rowdy. Our halftime show has become somewhat of an iconic halftime show. So even if fans aren't watching the game, they're tuning in at halftime to see who the act is. We also have a lot of young dancers come in from across the country, so the parents are obviously trying to see their children from home. And, you know, it's really up in the air to the TV crew whether or not ESPN's going to show the kids during the halftime show. And last year, it just didn't turn out that they had enough time to focus on the children that were here, and the parents went into an uproar. So we had to, you know, take the time and give them the attention that required to reply, say we're sorry. You know, thanks a lot. Thanks for tuning in. Wishing you a better second half. And then telling them, you know, that we recorded it. We'll mail them a DVD. We have in-stadium feed. So it's pretty good. And then also pregame and postgame are also really hot times for us, whether people are tailgating or at one of our events enjoying themselves or not enjoying themselves. We have a team in place so that way they can reply. And then, just like all these teams here do, we also like to feature posts and content on the Jumbotron. So we have a separate team that we bring in for that, just to make sure the content's appropriate, the pictures are right, the videos aren't offensive. So that's pretty cool, too. But it does require attention to make sure we don't mess that up.
That does require quite a bit of attention. So we got time for one more question. Anybody? Go ahead.
What are you guys doing, like, being here in Florida? What are you guys doing to try to engage and provide content in Spanish for all your Hispanic community?
You know, online, socially, digitally, we haven't focused too much just because our staff is not bilingual, and I would hate to make a mistake with our copy. With our ads, we do advertise on various Spanish radio stations, publications, and whatnot, so we'll use that creative and we'll push it out, but I think you're better to speak to this one.
Yes, let's speak with...
I touched a little bit on it. Major League Baseball from all 30 clubs takes an active approach towards engaging with our Spanish and our Latin fans. If you look at the Marlins account, we have Los Marlins accounts in our major platforms, and we actively create content that is specifically geared towards that, and we try to showcase our players that are Spanish-speaking. So, you know, what you see on English, you're going to see the same type of same content mirrored on Spanish, but paired along complementing it is content that's geared towards our Spanish speakers, and that extends beyond just a digital and social standpoint. You know, we do heritage nights. Again, we have 81 games, so we're afforded the opportunity to be pretty flexible. We do heritage nights for all different types of ethnicities.
Yes,
and backgrounds.
I know Dominican Heritage Night is the most popular.
It's pretty good, and you know,
I think
we're going to be having the World Baseball Classic in March, where we're going to have Canada, Colombia, the Dominican Republic, and United States.
Are they coming back?
Those four teams will be back March.
Amazing. That was the most filled I've ever seen that stadium. There was lines outside to get tickets.
Not only
when the Dominican Republic
not only
played.
In terms of the people, but the volume, because it's a different type of experience from baseball. People don't normally in baseball, people sit and, you know, you cheer when something big happens, but people are on their feet the entire time.
They bring the drums,
they bring the flags, and it's vibrant and it's eclectic, and we're very fortunate to be hosting it, and so is South Florida. So that event in itself, I think, is a great opportunity to kind of showcase our Spanish and our Latin efforts.
Absolutely. And of course, like you mentioned, Major League Baseball does have a massive Spanish language audience. Massive. I mean, it is really the number one sport in Latin America and in the Caribbean. I mean, there's soccer too. It's one of the number ones. It's one and 1A, let's call it. Some countries, it's definitely number one. Vincent?
I guess it's one thing that we did this past spring is we started international cheerleader auditions. We hosted auditions for our cheer squad in Rio de Janeiro, Buenos Aires, Bogota, and Mexico City. And I think we had a total of 11 ladies that have moved to the South Florida to become a part of our cheer squad. And starting today, we actually launched Dolphins Internacional, which is a branch off of our daily show that we do. It's called the Dolphins Daily. It's 90 seconds to 2.5 minutes of content that we push out on a daily basis. So now on a weekly basis, with the young ladies that now live in South Florida, today's first host was one of the cheerleaders that's from Mexico City. So we're producing this content purely for Spanish speakers, and it's going to be football content, but also giving them updates about what's occurring to our stadium, what we're doing in the community, and working with the NFL to target that to not only our audience. We have a very big audience in Mexico already, but we're going to use the NFL to help us target it, put some paid dollars behind it too to help it travel and get eyeballs on this content throughout the
That's pretty cool. I actually caught a Dolphins game when I was on vacation in Cancun, and they did a crowd interactivity, and all of the people that were on TV, on Mexican TV, were wearing Dolphins stuff. It's kind of crazy. Cedric?
Well, the biggest thing we try and do for our Spanish-speaking audience is create unique, original content for them. So, like, if you go to elheat.com, it's not just heat.com in Spanish. We have different stories there, different videos. We cover different events. So if we have a player who's in, you know, Hialeah or, you know, having an event on Cayocho, you'll find that there. You know, we don't want it to be just a mirror image of each other, just different words. On top of that, we have our Heritage Nights, which the NBA pushes as a whole. It's not just us.
Right, El Heat.
El Heat, yeah, El Heat Nights. So we do that. We do a lot with our Spanish radio broadcast. Jose Pineda, he's out in the community a lot. So like I say, the biggest thing is that we just don't want our Spanish audience to feel like, oh, like you're getting the same thing, just translate it. Like, you know, like you get stuff directed, you know, towards you, and that works out for us.
Follow-up question, are you guys bringing Carlos Arroyo back just for social media purposes?
It would be nice. I would love it. He's actually a pretty great guy, but I think he's a little past his prime, so.
Aww.
Unfortunately.
Well, hey, everybody, thank these guys. They came a long way for this. And thank you, guys. You've been a great panel.